Hi, everybody, and welcome to the Central Great Lakes Chapters Centered on Excellence webinar series as we discuss earning an Emmy today, superb storytelling and journalism that matters, what it takes to win an Emmy, what it takes to be a great storyteller. And we've got some great storytellers with us today. Carl Monday, longtime investigative reporter, who's been at just about every station in Cleveland through the years now at Fox 8. Ann Ryder, longtime anchor and reporter at WTHR. Leon Bibb, longtime anchor and reporter, WKYC, previously WEWS. And my colleague at Fox 59 CBS 4 in Indianapolis, Mike Sullivan, tremendous multimedia journalist, to talk more about the visual aspects of storytelling. It's great to have all of you with us today. I know some of you sort of doing different things than what you've done throughout the course of your long career in TV. Leon, I'll start with you. Tell us a little bit about what you're doing now and what you're most proud of throughout your career.
Well, right now I'm working, I'm mostly retired.
Mostly.
Although I do about 15 to 20 hours a week. I only do what I want to do. If I don't want to do it, I say I don't want to do that and I don't do it. But I'm at back where I started in Cleveland at WKYC, the NBC. And I'm senior, they call me senior commentator and reporter. And I do commentary mostly and enjoy it. And some long form features that I like to do. So that's what I'm doing now. After a 42 years in Cleveland and 50 years in all of television, Toledo and Cleveland, 50 straight.
That's incredible. Carl, I know you've also been doing this about as long throughout all the various things you've done in broadcasting. Tell us a little bit about what you're doing now. I see the, 50 Emmys behind you there as well. So you're a man who knows a thing or two about earning an Emmy.
Well, if you've been around long enough, you're going to win a few Emmys. When I was business, and it's been 50 years now, hoping to accomplish a couple of things. Do good journalism and do good television. And early on I discovered that if you do both, the chances are you're gonna have a long and productive career. And it also increases your chances, by the way, of winning your share of Emmys. But as we'll find out with a story of mine that we're gonna play in a little bit here, that's not always the case. But presently I've come full circle. My Cleveland television career started at WJW-TV in 1979. And for the last about 2.5 years, I've been an I-Team contributor. I was the I-Team reporter for 22 years. And I came back during the sweeps periods, I do an occasional story for Fox 8. So that's what I'm doing now.
Hey, we're coming up on sweeps. We're coming up today for all of you watching. When it comes to Emmys, coming up today on the deadline to enter your nominations, your submissions for this year's contest. So hopefully we can draw a little bit of inspiration, a little bit of advice from everybody here today. Ann Ryder with us, former anchor reporter at WTHR. Tell us a little bit more about what you're doing now.
Well, now trying to pass along whatever knowledge I gleaned to the next generation of storytellers. Business has certainly changed, but yeah, I asked you right before we began. I think the deadline for entering the college Emmys is coming up in about 2 weeks, and we're definitely going to have some of that we're entering. I love teaching journalism and video storytelling, and I call it that now because I get a lot of kids in class who aren't sure they want to go into broadcasting, and that's, it's understandable. But if you have the kind of skills, you can put together the kind of stories that do win Emmys, boy, you're golden in a number of professions. So
sure.
That's what I do. I love it.
And in so many different
university.
Yeah, at IU. And in so many different formats too, as well, these days. I mean, that could be storytellers on many different platforms, online and in television. Speaking of the next generation, my colleague, Mike Sullivan, has been with us for a couple of years. He hasn't been around in the business as long as some of these guys, but last couple of years, you've been winning Emmys here in our region for being an outstanding storyteller and an outstanding MMJ. And I think you can add a lot to the discussion when it comes to that process of going out and gathering the entire story, video, the process of shooting it, editing it, reporting it. You're out there doing it and doing some great work in that regard. Tell us a little bit about what you think it takes to be a great storyteller in this business.
Well, it's funny. I was laughing when Leon said that he gets to do what he wants now, because I'm not at that point. So I still sometimes have to do the stories that I'm given or push for the ones that I want. And a lot of the times, if I am pushing for the ones that I want and the producers know, it's because I know it's got the goods. It's got the character. It's got the visuals. It's got all the pieces. And generally in my head, I've already got something forming. So I've already got how I'm going to shoot it, how I'm going to write it, what I'm going to get into. Because when you are an MMJ, you're up against time, especially on that day-to-day basis. That is not your friend. Time is not your friend. So anything you can do to be ahead of the game, know what you're going to do, and learn to get a better workflow and process when you're shooting, that will help you write faster and better and clearer and more creative, which will help you edit faster, clearer, and more creative. Often I see people that go out and they just, they shoot everything, right? Like, oh, that's cool. That's cool. That's cool. That's cool. And don't think how it's going to relate. Then they get back and go, well, now what do I do? If you start streamlining that process, you can move a lot faster, which will let you do a lot more in a shorter amount of time and potentially win as many Emmys as we see on this panel.
Well, and what I like about this group today is we have some of you who focused on and Mike, as a, you know, as general assignment reporter, you do all kinds of stories, but really, I think you would agree that your, you know, your bread and butter, your jam is kind of telling a really compelling feature story that involves great characters and great personalities. You know, Carl's focus was really more on investigative reporting, but even in those kinds of very serious reports, there's still an aspect of storytelling, visual storytelling, that makes it come to life and focusing on those personal characters. So you've all brought clips with you today that I've got here that we're going to share. And Leon, I'll start with you. You brought a clip from your time back at across the street on a story you did about a boxing gym, which really just lends itself to a lot of great natural sound and visuals. Tell us a little bit about it, and then we'll pull it up here.
Yeah, when we got there, we realized that this story was more than just a gym, that the owner of the boxing gym really made this place part of his life. And without the gym, I don't know if he'd still be breathing. And we got into it, and we realized that he had a long history with boxing. That's his picture right there. And Gary Horvath, he had a lot of history with boxing and with the Olympic boxing team and things like that. And he's kind of a father figure for the guys who come in and the women who come in. And there's a piece in there where we interview a woman who's throwing the leather in training. And we edited it so that we could really capitalize on the natural sound of those shots going into the pads. So,
well, let's watch a little bit up here.
Okay.
There's a West Side Cleveland spot where fists are flying right now. It's a fight, but a friendly one, where boxers are mixing it up in a gym. However, this Mile High with Leon Bibb story goes far beyond boxing. Leon handles the story from ringside.
Move, work, move, come. Move your head. Throw the hook. Right hand.
They are throwing the leather. Don't throw it hard and fast enough, and someone else's leather will throw you. Better to give than to receive. Boxing demands constant attention. From ringside, it looks one way. Center ring, it can rock you. Ringside at Make Them Pay Old Angle Boxing Gym. Longtime mainstay of Cleveland's West 25th Street. Boxers hoping to move up train here. That's Corey Gregory and Brendan Hunter mixing it up. Different weight classes, yeah, but this is just sparring, working out, both training for sanctioned bouts where they really lay it on the line.
So I try to, you know, let them know it's a long, rigorous road to be a boxer. Time!
Wise advice from a boxing guru at home in the ring. Gary Horvath owns and manages Make Them Pay Old Angle Boxing Gym. 57 years ago, he first laced up his own gloves. Later, sports writers dubbed him that classy kid from Cleveland. Horvath never left the game. At 67, he stays in as gym owner, which also means being
custodian, concession stand, make popcorn, clean out the gym, leave my family on the holidays and come up here so the youngsters can work out.
In his day, Horvath was feisty, fleet on his feet, fast with the fists, a Cleveland amateur champ who almost made it to the 64 and 68 U.S. Olympics boxing teams. Now around his sweat-stained equipment and paint-peeled walls, he and his old angle save lives. No matter a fighter's background or gender, all that matters is...
One! The money is green and the blood is red. Throw everything else out the window.
Ten! You're out!
A lot of the fighters here are off the streets of Cleveland. Some have seen tough times. But Gary Horvath gives them all something special. Camaraderie. And that makes them all winners.
You know, Leon, I've always thought of you as something of a wordsmith, right? Sweat-stained, paint-peeled, adding those kinds of adjectives in there. And just really emphasizing this guy's nickname, the classy kid from Cleveland, and emphasizing that in your scripting with a lot of personality. I think that all comes to life in this story. And like you said, it's a story that takes a couple of turns as well. What else for this particular story really came to life for you?
Well, it was like, I'm a fan of vintage Hollywood, and I love looking at those old 1940s and 1930s movies. It felt like I was in the 1940s or early 50s in the old boxing gym, if you look at some of those old boxing Hollywood boxing films. And it felt like that. It smelled like that. It looked like that. And I wanted to capitalize. In fact, I wouldn't have mind even shooting this thing in black and white. I wouldn't have mind shooting that way, but it, so that's one of the things I got. And I got into Gary Horvath, and he became really, we're in touch with each other still. He's kind of a friend. And I got into his life as to why he's there, and the gym is his life and the lives of those who go. So it's really more than about the sport. It's about, they found something that keeps them going. And that's one of the things I wanted to pull out.
And also the woman, the young woman you just saw there, you mentioned earlier, ended up being a big part of this story as well.
Yeah. She was a student at Kent State University. She was 20 years old when we did this. And she wanted to go into boxing, but she's training. I forgot what her major is at Kent State University, but she loved the ring. And we talked back and forth. We actually put a mic on her to when she was throwing the leather so we could get that pop, 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 pop. You know, that natural sound. We love that.
He knows the fight game.
Aging prize fight.
It's all about the natural sound. It's all about the characters. I mean, we'll talk about that a lot here today, especially in a story like this that's, you know, that's more of a feature story. But it's also important, right, in investigative stories. Carl, you know, this is a story that you did back in the early 90s about a doctor who got in trouble, people who ended up dying because of prescriptions he was giving to them. And you were able to really start that story on a, you know, on a very personal note with one of the widows affected by this. Tell us a little bit about this story as we get it ready to play here.
Yeah, I mean, one thing I want to point out to everybody out there is that one good way to win a lot of Emmys is to surround yourself with good people. And Mark DiMarino, my producer, and I put together the story on Dr. Charles Dunover. Let's watch a little bit of it.
Dunover attempted to obtain a restraining order to block the airing of tonight's report. Well, late this afternoon, a judge denied the request. An I-team probe discovered that three of Dr. Charles Dunover's patients have turned up dead in recent months from an accidental drug overdose after receiving prescriptions from that doctor.
Carl Monday and the I-team found that Dunover has a penchant for prescribing inappropriate and excessive treatment and ignored the advice of another doctor that in some cases his treatment may be doing more harm than good.
Well, Tim and Robin, this is really the story of Joseph Malinak, William Crawford, and David Haney. They're not here to personally tell you about their experiences. They're all dead from a fatal overdose that included prescription drugs. As far as we can tell, Malinak, Crawford, and Haney didn't know each other, but they had one thing in common. They were all patients of Dr. Charles Dunover.
I remember everything. I love him to death. I mean, He was my first boyfriend, my first I love you, my first everything. He was my whole life.
Debbie and Joe Malinak were committed to spending their lives together. A tragic series of events pulled them apart forever. In 1987, Joe was hit by a drunk driver. The accident didn't kill him, but the drugs he came to rely on to kill the pain eventually did. 6 years after the accident, Malinak was working as a safety inspector on an asbestos job here at the old Coit Road plant. A scaffold fell, sending Malinak crashing to the ground, resulting in a painful back injury and more medication to ease the pain. Malinak filed a workers' comp claim and was referred to Dr. Charles Dunifer, who, along with his partner, operates this industrial clinic at East 30th near Superior. Malinak had already grown addicted to painkillers from the old auto accident, but that didn't stop Dr. Dunifer from prescribing three potentially addictive drugs, diazepam, propoxyphene, and carisoprodol. The physician's desk reference says propoxyphene, commonly sold as Darvon or Darvocet, can cause death in patients with previous histories of misuse of tranquilizer and sedative drugs. Debbie began seeing a change in her husband. He refused to eat. All he would do is sleep.
And I called this doctor a million times. I would call him from payphones. I would go see him myself. I go, you better knock this off. I go, you're going to end up killing the guy.
And that's what happened, unfortunately. Carl, what strikes me here is that, you know, even though through the years of the way graphics and the presentation and animations might change, HD instead of standard def, I mean, the focus of a story, of a great news story, has always been finding the people it impacts, getting you to trust them to tell their story. And that's clearly what you did here.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, this is a 10-minute piece with the anchor intros and tags and everything. And it's a lot to ask for, unless, you know, of a viewer, unless they're watching 60 minutes. But we thought it was an important story. And we did more than a dozen parts over a 3-year period. And one of the points I wanted to get across is that, you know, one of my golden rules of reporting is that, you know, you take every tip seriously, and, you know, you never give up on a story that you truly believe in, because this came in as just the tip of another overdose in the city, which there were probably 300 that year. And we began to peel back the layers, and, you know, we went, first thing we did, we went to the coroner's office and we started looking through autopsy reports to see if there were any other deaths. And we found two other deaths with the same doctor within a month's time. So, you know, we went undercover at Dr. Dunifer's office.
There's some of the undercover video there.
You're looking at the undercover video right there. Back then you could do that sort of thing. Today, your attorneys wouldn't let you do it, but. So then we tipped off, at some point we had to tip off law enforcement because we didn't want anybody else to get killed. And, you know, within a short period of time, they went and raided the doctor's office. The county prosecutor got involved. There was a trial. Dunifer became the, and this is what, why I singled the story out, because Dunifer became the first Ohio physician in Ohio history to be convicted on charges of manslaughter in the accidental overdose death of a patient. But the story didn't end there. I think that my favorite part, and I wish we had time to play it, maybe at another webinar, but just like days before he was supposed to be sentenced in these crimes for killing his patients, we got a tip that he was going to flee the country back to the Philippines. So through some back channels, we set up a phony passport scheme. And we met Dunifer. There's Dunifer outside his office, but we met him in a parking lot. And he posed for a picture with our Polaroid camera, and we gave him a phony passport, and he gave us, I forget how much money for the passport, and we immediately called law enforcement, and they went and arrested him at his home. He was out on bond, and they arrested him. We had him being arrested out of his house. And then when he finally went to court a few days later, the judge sentenced him to 4 years in prison for the facts that we gathered in our story and the investigators gathered. And the judge, citing our stories, tacked on yet another year because Dunifer was trying to flee the country. So again, you know, this was a commitment by the station because we spent a heck of a lot of time on it. And as I mentioned before, in our little talk before, this is a story that never won an Emmy for investigative reporting. And I always wonder why, you know.
Who was judging that year?
You know, was it a case of maybe the stories were too long? Maybe they, you know, for the format that we were using at the time, maybe, you know, I took too long to get to the meat of the story. You know, and maybe somebody had just simply had something better that year. I don't know, but it was always a mystery to me. But maybe we can talk a little bit more about that when we talk about you know, what you can do to kind of make sure your entries are in the right category and they're presented in the
right way. And right.
But yeah, that's the backstory on that story.
Great piece of journalism. And, you know, obviously, you know, as we said there, the, you know, being able to, you know, start that story with the story of a woman who lost her husband as a result, you know, is always, it's always so important to really cut to, you know, the people that our stories impact. And Anne, you really showcased that here in a story that you did back in 2000 that highlights how various tragedies can impact people's lives by way of organ transplants. And you really had some really stunning access here to the process and what people were experiencing as that was happening in real time in the hospital. Tell us a little bit about that.
What's unusual is that this is about what happens when there's an accident and someone has expressed the desire to donate their organs. Wasn't planning to do a story on this. At the time we were doing the Riley Telethon, Children's Telethon, and there was a girl over in Riley, young girl, hooked up to an artificial heart machine waiting for a heart. So this night I was anchoring the news at this point. We led the news with the story you're about to see, part of it. And I got a call from Methodist Hospital, come down. We think this girl that was in the accident on life support may be a match for Kayla. So what unfolded in the ensuing hours, she wasn't a match for Kayla, but through some sort of, it really was most unusual. I was permitted to go upstairs. Indiana organ transplant procurement, usually these doors are very shut, just opened up access, and we were able to follow from the moment of taking somebody off life support all the way through to donating five different donations that came from this one girl. It's a longer story than I just, you know, summarized. The family was remarkable. Understood right away the bigger picture, how many people could be affected. And you know, clearly the biggest story I was ever involved in was going to Calcutta with Mother Teresa. This got more mail, more response, more email than any other story I ever did.
Yeah. And
obviously, we've had a bad accident here at 252. It has been a head-on collision.
The accident was breaking news at 6 o'clock and breaking hearts. A mother and toddler dead, a teenage girl riding with them airlifted to Methodist Hospital. Elizabeth Underwood was on life support when her family arrived at the hospital and made the decision which would alter the course of five lives. Beth Underwood was her mother's daughter. Sensitive and private, loving and kind, with imaginary friends and real ones.
His name's Gary.
Gary?
Beth's father died before she mastered a two-wheeler and turned five. After her mother's remarriage, Beth blended into a new family who loved her like their own. At age 14, Beth was about to bloom. Three hours after the accident, Beth's parents tried to summon the courage to say goodbye to their daughter, who was brain dead.
She's on the respirator. I'm still able to touch her. She's, you know, her body still feels like Beth, and I feel like she's still there, and I'm hoping that when we go home, that she'll feel there and not missing. You know, I want her to, she'll be in my heart. I just hope we don't have that big hole in our house that we seem to have right now.
But there was already a hole in their heart. 2 months before she died, Beth told her parents if anything ever happened to her, she wanted to donate her organs. They'll honor her wish.
And this is And this is incredibly chilling. And it's because they let you come along and show people what that process is like and what it meant to them.
The key to it, and this was, you know, I knew the public relations person at Methodist, but the key was Beth's mother told her before they pulled her off, she said, you know, out of the clear blue the other day, Beth said, Mom, if anything ever happens to me, I want to donate the organs. And the PR person told me that. So that was kind of the springboard to go upstairs and talk to the parents. One of the hardest things I've ever done. And they, you know, as long as we maintained her dignity and stayed in the background, they got it. So we ended up following. I told the story in a nonlinear fashion, and I try to teach that. Some stories are, they work better that way. You don't always do it chronologically, you know. And so this one, especially since it had such a high emotional impact, it's almost like when you're watching a movie and you almost can't take it anymore, and then they cut to something lighter. I felt it was important to cut back and forth in order to tell the whole story. And then the rest of the story was somebody who ended up getting Beth's liver, who still is doing well with it. I'm still in touch with the families, all of the families who were the recipients of Beth's gift. And this one, if you're ever driving around Greenwood and you see a little license plate that says number four, Beth, that's Eric Passmore. This guy who got her liver. So, and the parents finally met. So anyway, that one had as big an emotional impact all the way across as anything I ever did.
That's a great story. You bring up a good point though, that, are we still watching here? I guess we are.
Oh, go ahead.
No.
I was just going to mention that, that's exactly what I consciously try to do that. Like every 30 seconds in a report, I try to shift gears a little bit.
Yes.
It doesn't have to be a drastic shift, but just something to grab the attention of the viewers, make sure they're, you know, not falling asleep and balance out the story. Yeah.
Let's listen to the end of this one.
The life she lived and ultimately gave. There are no regrets.
Hold them and love them every day. It's so short, so unpredictable, so unknown that you just appreciate every day and love them like it's your last.
Wow. Dan, I'm so glad you went on that last shot. So I had this incredible photographer, and our photographers are every bit as much the journalists. And he was one of those, he could hear the sound bites.
And he moved off of her. That's a bold choice for a photographer to make right there. Yeah.
And saw the closing shot, you know, and he was just a master. We were talking earlier about working with photographers and you become a team. Yeah. You learn how the other ones think. That's why I'm so interested to hear from our MMJ, because they do it all. And frankly, I don't know how you do it. I teach it, but I don't know how you do it.
Sometimes you get to work with a photographer, but I know you you enjoy the fact that you MMJ too. You like it a lot.
I do. I'm a weirdo. So I actually really, I fell in love shooting. I started my career in Minnesota, which is like a storytelling, like superpower, no matter where you are. So when you've got literally like Boyd Hubert and Chad Nelson, who are both, for lack of a better term, goats in your backyard, you start kind of looking and sharing, and especially when you're just starting things out. And so it's interesting. I do work with photographers, and sometimes it's hard because I'm so used to being the hands-on part that I have to let go. And a lot of our photographers, I bring my phone with me and I have a whole microphone that connects, and I will shoot alongside my photographers sometimes. So if they pick up that gnat sound that you really want, but maybe they're focused on something else, my brain, I'm literally watching them. I can probably tell you what my photographer shot without seeing the video, just by watching their mannerisms, how they move, where they're angled, what they have. And I'm constantly trying to figure out what they don't have. And I am shooting those shots. So if they do drop a gnat sound, I already have the shot that gets them in and out of it without them having to think if they didn't get it. So that's how my brain is always working. And then you start learning from your photographer. So like some of the stuff you're about to see in the piece here, and if we are showing the other piece, Jamie Suter is one of our amazing photographers, and he was able to kind of get my brain around some different things. But let me, I'll let you watch and then we'll talk about it.
Yeah, so this is a piece you won an Emmy for in 2020 about this precious little guy who had to have all of his limbs amputated, Mike?
Yeah, so all four are amputated. And if you want to pause it, because I think it's about to go.
Yeah.
The thing with
we don't need to see the anchor intro. We've seen that guy before.
So the thing about this story is actually it's based out of my first nomination, which was the year prior. So this is the follow up to it. Yes, he had all four limbs amputated. And what you need to know, and what you will hear, because part of my original first nomination is in this story, is he was given this stuffed animal by another kid who had his knee amputated down. And the stuffed animal had also had the same limbs amputated. And the point was that the boy told him, superheroes can be superheroes no matter what. And so going in, I knew that I had that nugget. And so from there, the rest of the theme is born. But I'll let you watch it and then I'll continue on to how that sort of brainchild goes. But in back to shooting and writing, some of the stuff you see in here, which is a day turn, you kind of got to learn how to do these things before you do them. Because if you do them on a day turn, trying to learn how to do them and do them under that timeline, impossible.
I know you put a lot of planning into that. Let's watch this. It's a great piece.
Superhero stories follow a pattern. It's not where they begin.
No.
Falter or fail. It's where they discover what makes them special.
He has superpowers that other, can I have high fives, children may not have at this age.
But to understand this three-year-old's strength.
Say my name is Jeremiah.
Is to go back to the beginning. Jeremiah Cox was rushed to the hospital in September of 2018. A mystery illness had gone septic, consuming his little body.
In this case, amputation was done above both knees and above both elbows.
At first, I didn't have hope.
Good job!
And now I do.
A fellow child amputee made Jeremiah a clever piece of foreshadowing.
Cut off the arms and the legs.
Same.
Superheroes can still be superheroes, no matter what.
Now, a year later.
Wiggle, wiggle, wiggle.
Therapists at Riley say he's figured out how to get around by hopping and squirming.
He has to learn how to bear weight on his legs before he's ever going to be able to walk.
This means painful stretching and overcoming fears.
We swing our arms. We know we can protect ourselves if we fall.
Jeremiah only recently got his.
He sees that toy that he really, really loves. Keep going. Keep going. And then he's just so willing to work hard.
For him, that's using his shoulders and prosthetics to reach for dinosaurs.
He can use those two hands together, or he can just use one hand at a time.
Like a human T-Rex, his favorite dinosaur.
I think maybe he sees himself in him. Boom.
Physically different in some ways.
Help me! Help me!
But to his family, still king of the world.
And literally, I look for hope in him.
Pull, 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 go!
Inspiration. Perhaps that's it.
Which one do you want to get first?
A superpower we can all get behind.
You think you're going to change the world?
In Indianapolis, I'm Mike Sullivan. Fox 59 News.
Love the superhero theme, Mike. I mean, this one just tugs at my heart as a dad of a little kid. For every parent seeing his, you know, his little character from not Paw Patrol, but with the amputated character and his dinosaurs and everything. Oh my gosh. Wow. This is what we aim to do in TV, right? It's to inspire people. And you did it here.
Exactly. And so I knew I had the superhero theme. So heading into it, I was like, okay, I want to make him a superhero. And now I have some better filters than what I had to make it look like a comic book. But it's the thing where an MMJ, you're shooting, writing, and editing. And when you start to learn more about each piece, it almost changes how you do other parts of it. So I knew I had comic book filters. I knew I had the kind of changing page edit that lets you go back. So I thought, okay, well, I need that because I know I have to go back to the first story to get to the bite, because the bite where he talks about having the stuffed animal is from the original story.
They didn't have the comic book filters on the editing machine when you started out, Carl.
And so I knew I could, and then, so then I do with these things called, it's kind of leading into this next tour, I call them kind of like set pieces. which in soccer, they have things called like set pieces when you're kind of kicking the ball out or whatever, where the team has a play that they can run, because the rest of the time in soccer, you're just kind of moving and flowing. So I knew that I was going to do the page turn to make the comic book animate. So when I go to shoot, I go, okay, I have to get that element. And then I knew I had other parts. I knew that he liked the T-Rex. And then as you're going to write now, you already have the pieces because you thought about them ahead of time. And sort of it's like the pre-planned element, and especially which this one was done in a day, you only have so much time. So you need to kind of have those things planned so when you get back, you can keep going forward. And then the rest just kind of all comes. And the same thing goes to how you maybe steer your questions. So, you know, you can ask them, does he feel like a superhero? And you're going to get some of those things that are pulled out, which of course everybody in the room thinks he is. So it just kind of plays in.
And here's another story you did that kind of focuses on another inspirational character, those stories that can truly inspire people.
Yes, and it has elements of both in the fact that this story had stuff that was pre-planned, and because I was behind the lens, stuff that just came out.
So this is a story you shot as well here.
Those indelible moments.
First time it really was noticeable that it was going.
Thought lost forever.
I couldn't see a picture of my daughter on the wall.
That is until technology ramped up as Chris Blake's eyesight came down.
Iris vision helps a person who is legally blind.
It allows me to zoom in.
We are remapping everything on the digital screen on the inside, and it's close enough to his eyes.
No, it's not sci-fi. But Iris vision utilizes a virtual reality headset with a Samsung phone. That way, Chris can make the most of his time.
They gather up their snowballs.
A precious commodity, as you will soon learn.
I have what they call ocular histoplasmosis.
A fungus common to the area.
If you get it just in your bloodstream, you can be treated with antifungals.
To the eyes, however.
Off the lawn and down the street.
It's debilitating.
At that point, no antifungal will touch it.
His wife, Vanessa.
Was a shot put and discus thrower in high school.
A record holder turned medical assistant on the verge of taking classes to help Chris.
And now, she's in a chair. She can barely lift her arm.
Vanessa was diagnosed with ALS, given 2 to 5 years to live.
Disease has taken almost everything from her.
Her old voice now captured in a doll. While her purpose still remains.
Now she's my eyes, a blurry spot. I'm her hands.
It's simple. Vanessa instructs.
Follow on me.
He follows, with help, of course.
Figure out if this was the right pill or not to give her.
The headset zooming in prescriptions.
Read it out to me.
Citrate Palm offers higher absorption,
allowing him to become the medical assistant.
It's given back an aspect of life that I thought I'd lost.
Even if his biggest loss.
She has written out letters.
Still approaches.
Cards for myself or daughter.
They are future anniversaries, birthdays.
I don't want to, because reading these means she's gone.
At least now.
No one else has to read them to me.
In Greenwood, I'm Mike Sullivan, Fox 59 News.
Mike, what another compelling human story that you found here about this couple helping each other any way they could.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think it's the beginning of the piece, which we missed a little bit of. The whole beginning of the piece actually starts in blur. And that is something I had this piece is a mixture of pre-planned stuff and planned and not planned things. So I wanted to start it in blur because that's what he sees. He's blind. He doesn't see. So I wanted to start in blur and come into that clarity, which is a tough choice because if you're watching and you're like, why is this blurry? Is, you know, something wrong with my TV? But it kind of breaks it into that. I knew I wanted to do that. I knew I had a Zoom call, and I hate what Zoom calls look like. So that's why I had to figure out how to make it look like goggles and look like he was looking at it. But all the other parts all came from being behind the camera. So I lined up a shot on the fridge and of her with the shot put. And then the reporter in me goes, well, what's the shot put? And that's when I learned that she was, that she was like a state ranked shot putter, but I wouldn't have known that if I wasn't behind the camera.
Being curious, being observant. So important, yeah. Right? Exactly.
I was shooting video of the bunny and her daughter, the daughter goes, oh, mommy's in the bunny. And I go, well, what does that mean? Oh. You know, and the dad says, that's where the voice, they saved her voice in it before she lost it with you know, with her illness. And then the cards came out of left field too. I was shooting a bunch of cutaway shots and she kept motioning over to this box. And so finally the husband said, oh, well, you got to get the letters. I go, what's the letters? He goes, she wrote about 100 letters for me, for my wife and my daughter for the rest of our lives that are bad hair days, bad breakups. Even after mom passes, she can still talk to her daughter. And these are reveals that happen while you're shooting, while you're going. So even when you plan a bunch of set pieces, a bunch of things you're going to do, you have to pivot when you see those things. But some of those things don't pop up unless you are behind the camera, you know, and you notice things. I mean, even yesterday, we did a story of a lieutenant who had passed, killed in the line of duty a few years ago. And I was talking to the to his mother and his brother. And I noticed that both of them have a piercing that is similar of a diamond right here. And the photographer in me goes, okay, why do they have the same thing? That's something I probably need to do. And the reporter in me asks, is that for your brother? Or is that for the lieutenant? They said, absolutely. It's basically like a diamond eardrop for him. Now it's something I can write to. It's a theme, it's a narrative. It's something I can weave. But if I wasn't, if I didn't think visually, because I'm Jay, I might not have picked it up.
We've learned so much about storytelling here. I know we're running out of time. I'm letting your, I think your station was going to get a clip of you doing this today, Leon. So I've let them in here as well. And I've got another clip of a story you recently did here at WKYC about a Cleveland rock and roll legend who's really kind of the father of rock and roll, right? Tell us a little bit about the story that we're about to see here.
Yeah, this story is about Alan Freed, who didn't, he popularized the phrase rock and roll. Rock and roll came out of old, what was called race music, black rhythm and blues music. He popularized that phrase. It really has to do with sexual activity, rocking and rolling all night long. But it's a family show, Leon. but one of the things that a lot of folks did not know, but I remember because my parents talked about it all the time, my having grown up in Cleveland, was the very first rock and roll riot was in Cleveland. Mm-hmm. Came as a result of Alan Freed and his Moondog Show, as you will see in this piece.
News senior commentator Leon Bibb takes us back to the 1950s and the music DJ who started spinning it all.
Who would have thought that a rock and roll show that spiraled into a riot decades ago would have helped set the stage for Cleveland becoming the city for the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame? More on a strange story of 70 years ago about rock and roll's beginning and how Cleveland played the early notes of a music which would sweep the world. Get into my time machine and let's go back to the early 1950s radio music show hosted by the disc jockey Alan Freed.
Hello, everybody. How are you all tonight? This is Alan Freed, the old king of the Moondog.
He was a Cleveland radio host who was the first to take black rhythm and blues music and introduce it on a far larger scale to white kids itching to hear more of it. Alan Freed on his Cleveland show, The Moondog Rock and Roll House Party. Now, in the industry, black rhythm and blues was called race music, and there was no crossover until Cleveland's Freed crossed it over, playing the rhythm and blues for his station's white listeners and new black listeners. Rock and roll. It wasn't Freed's term, but it originated in an early rhythm and blues lyric referring to romantic involvement.
It was 1950s radio, and I was way too young to fully understand what was going on. But my parents and my aunts and uncles tuned in to Alan Freed's Moondog radio show and talked about it. They tuned in to hear Freed spinning those records. It was rhythm and blues. It was rock and roll.
Freed called himself King of the Moondoggers.
I love it, Leon. I love the historical perspective you're able to add to these stories. And then photographer and editor who worked on the piece too, yeah, really helped bring it to life with some great sound effects, with the old record scratching noise. And you have the old radio, yeah, there with you in the stand-up. Great stuff.
Yeah, in fact, I bought that radio some years ago at a flea market for pieces like this. I got a whole bunch of old, it's like my, the behind a movie theater, behind a stage theater, a lot of stuff I've got, all kinds of stuff like old radios and things like that. But I wanted the public to know about where rock and roll came from, seeing that the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame is in Cleveland, but where the phrase came from, and that these are images right here of the first rock festival that turned into a riot right there in downtown Cleveland. That was the first riot at a rock and roll show. Well, all of that came right out of Cleveland, and most of the people I work with had no knowledge of this at all, but it was something that I had in the back of my mind, having talked to my parents and my aunts and uncles when I was growing up, because I remember them talking about the Moondog Show.
Oh, that's great stuff.
Can I also say that his voice is 100,000% perfect for this story? Like, that for me, I'm like, I'm sitting here like I could watch this for another half an hour if he just talks. I wish I had your voice. My voice is too high. I'm jealous.
Well, no, your voice is wonderful for what you're doing. I want to tell Anne, your whispering voice on the piece you did, Anne, was absolutely wonderful.
Good. Oh, thank you.
Everybody's got a different delivery, right? And it can lend itself to different kinds of reporting. But yeah, I mean, Anne's delivery in that piece, which was so emotional and compelling and personal and profound, and Leon, the vigor that you're able to add into these stories about rock and roll and boxing, you feel it. You know, when you're voicing the story, you feel it, and it comes off there in this report and in so much of the work that you do.
Sometimes a reporter has to look at the piece. What kind of piece is this that I'm doing? And sometimes you bring a little shtick. And I will bring some theater to a lot of the pieces that I do if I think that it will lend to my storytelling ability. I'll do whatever I got to do to help sell that story.
Well, I'll tell you what. Go ahead, Ann.
Oh, just real quickly, one thing I observed, Mike, with your stories is something, and it popped out because it's what I'm trying to teach right now in my introductory class, how many close-ups you have and how many faces. And that's the one thing I don't see from the students right off the bat. You have to tell them action, reaction, close-up, extreme close-up. And you get a lot of those, it's clear.
A lot of those tight shots that you talk about get you out of editing holes. Because again, when you're starting out, I mean, one of the problems is that sort of like paralysis. And again, as the clock is ticking, because you're running out of time to deadline and you're stuck there, like, I just wasted 5 minutes trying to cover 3 seconds because I can't figure out what to go. And so a lot of times it's not only getting the tights, but it's getting those cutaway shots. So like cutaways. Sometimes you'd see my subjects in the background and something in the foreground. Those are just get out of jail free cards. I mean, that's easily, and a lot of times when I do shoot with my phone alongside photographers, I'm just getting them get out of jail free cards. So when they go back to edit, they don't get slowed down, because we do something we call scribble horsing. There's a picture that shows a picture of a horse and the whole front of it is beautifully done. And then the back is just traced almost like some crude drawing from a child. And it's because you spent the first 45 minutes editing beautiful, ran out of time to deadline and went, okay.
Right.
And you just
wallpaper. Yeah.
Carl, storytelling is horse. Carl, storytelling's changed so much over the years, hasn't it?
Yeah. But you know, I think one common theme throughout this webinar is that, good interviews make for great stories. And sometimes all you have to do, you all know, you turn on the camera and that's all you got to do. I mean, you don't even have to ask more than a couple of questions and they pour their heart out to you. But most of the time, I think you really have to be prepared. And this is something I learned early on that, you know, I got to the point that I felt I could just go out and wing it, that I could go out and just interview anybody with questions from the top of my head. Then I was reading an interview with the great Mike Wallace from 60 Minutes. And he said that for every interview, no matter if he was interviewing, you know, the king of Egypt or, you know, some gas station operator, he would always prepare a full legal pad full of questions before he went out. And I thought, if that's good enough for Mike Wallace, it's good enough for me. And it did make me a better interviewer because I had to really think through. And you don't necessarily have to follow every question, you know, or ask every question that's on the pad, but you got to be ready. You got to go there prepared. And I think everything, every piece I saw in here contained save maybe for the last one that Leon did because it was self-containing, but I think there were great interviews on each of those pieces.
And that's such a big part of it, right? Preparation and planning. You know, Mike, Ann, you talked about that, everything that went into those stories through the years. Really great to have so many great minds here today to give some inspiration, give some advice to everybody on this last day to enter for this year's Emmys. I got to say, you all have done so much for our chapter through the years. Leon is going to just briefly highlight this too, because you mentioned it earlier, 50 years in television for both you and Carl, and your station recently did something to mark that occasion. You both have done so much for our chapter and for the viewers in our region through the years. And so we're actually going to surprise a couple of you here today to recognize your success and your longevity. Carl, Leon, you didn't know we were going to do this today, but we've got a special surprise. Our Gold and Silver Circle Committee wants to invite you both into our Gold Circle for 50 years of broadcasting excellence. Congratulations.
Woohoo! Wow. I hadn't planned on getting here that fast.
It seemed like we just had the 25th.
Right. Carl and I have been out on the streets of Cleveland opposite each other for years. And
it makes it all worthwhile, though.
Really, I think we honored you too late for the 25th. So we're making sure that in a timely way, we're getting to both of you here on your 50th year in broadcasting to welcome you into the Gold Circle. Leon and Carl, you've both meant so much to Cleveland Television and to our chapter, and we're honored to extend that invitation to you this year.
Well, congratulations to you, Leon, and thank you to the committee and to the chapter. What an honor.
I want to thank everybody who had anything to do with it. I appreciate that, and thank all the photographers and editors and producers and news directors and general managers and everybody else who brought
save
me
the
along.
Save the speech.
Yeah, save the speech.
I feel the speech coming on.
Hope to have an event for it all this summer, and we'll have more Gold and Silver Circle announcements in the months ahead as well. So stay tuned, and a big thanks to all of you for taking part in our webinar today. It's been an honor, and an honor to hear everything about what you all do to tell stories. There's the little graphic we had made too there with the Gold and Silver logo and Carl and Leon and their great work through the years, guys. Congratulations, and we look forward to honoring you for real here this summer, but wanted to let you know about that surprise here today. And we also want to let everybody know about the entry deadline. It is today. It's at midnight. Time is running out on the call for entries for this year's awards. Hopefully you got some great inspiration, some great advice today from these great broadcasters in our region. There is still a window of time the next few days where you can enter during our late period, pay a late fee to get in during that grace period. But the deadline to pay the normal entry fee is today. We want to tell you about a couple of our other webinars coming up in February. We'll be talking about covering our community is the importance of inclusion and diversity, as Harry Boomer and Sia New Yorker from WOIO join me to moderate that discussion. In March, we'll be talking about making TV magic in the midst of this pandemic we've been experiencing the last 2 years. And in April, preparing for your first job or your next job, something that I know Ann at IU, you're doing to get those students prepared for going into broadcasting and hopefully trying to compete with and excel with the likes of all of these great broadcasters we have with
Absolutely.
Us.
Absolutely.
This was a lot of fun. Thanks, everybody.
Thanks, Dan, for doing this. Yes, great.
Thanks a lot.
Great discussion. Thanks, Leon, guys. Carl, congratulations again.
Thank you.
Take care, everybody. Thanks so much.
Bye.
Bye-bye.